Good morning. There are times when compliments make you feel good, and then there are those times when they put pressure on you. So when somebody says you are best at something, that's pressurizing. Children, have you heard this word called genius? Yeah? Have you heard this word genius? Girls right at the back. And have you also heard your parents sometimes tell you, you know, that child in the neighborhood is a genius? Or that uncle's son is a genius? Why are you not genius? I don't know about you guys, but my parents asked me a lot of times why I wasn't. So I found out the origin of the word genius. It actually comes from the word genie. So when the word was invented, so these people who had these lovely, big, bright ideas, they used to say, genie came to me and gave me the idea. So it is not my permanent state. I was in my genius state when the genie was in me. Now the genie is not there, I don't have pressure. So when Priyadeep says, best, genie in me that day. Students, can I get a raise of hands from students? Let me see how many of them are there. Okay. You've heard a lot of adults talk already. It's time that adults listen to you. So I'm going to give you an offer. Listen to this one very carefully. There are 5 chairs on the panel right now. There are 3 people seated there. 1 chair I will take. There is 1 chair vacant. If you go to school as a student and want to come and fill up that chair, your chance is now. Which student wants to come over? Okay. First mover's advantage. Introduce to the group your name, your class.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Veda Raju of class 9 from Loyola Bhubaneswar.
Lovely. Please take a seat. In the process, we'll invite a couple of more students. So stay tuned when the opportunity comes. We'll try to invite some teachers as well. So without further ado, I go to future of classroom learning. Disclaimer, I have no idea what's going to look like. So I'm really hopeful that we'll find some answers from the panel. Okay, so we've got 27 minutes, 41 seconds now. We are going to do sort of rapid fires. If you speak too long, I will ask the sound to shut your mic. or have the buzzer going. No, I wouldn't do any of that. My first question straight away goes to Vipul. Now, Vipul represents Khan Academy. Do people know Khan Academy? Yeah, some people know Khan Academy already. So they have a lot of students, but they don't have classrooms. Or they have very, very few classrooms. They have 1 school? They actually have 1 school, and they have millions of students.
1 classroom.
Huh? 1 school, 1 physical classroom. And how many million kids as students?
About 60 million.
60 million kids as students. So I'll throw my first question to you. Now, we understand that your platform allows children to learn, or adults, to learn at their own pace. They can do that. But how does your system now say, you figured this out, perhaps this is your natural progression going forward? How do you keep that engagement going, and how do you keep the progression going?
So, thanks for the question, by the way. So, basically, on Khan Academy, there's 3 major sort of tenets or pedagogical tenets that we follow when we've actually designed this entire website. The first was basically, you know, keeping it very customized, so it's very personalized to your needs. The second is that we want you to basically get to mastery, to mastery of whatever it is that you're trying to learn. And the third thing was that we wanted you to develop a growth mindset, which is, and we'll talk about that in just a second. How many over here know, by the way, what is a growth mindset? A few, okay. So let's just talk about each of these. So on Khan Academy, I'll start probably with the last one. You know, a growth mindset. Basically, which says that you award the essentially there's quite a bit of philosophy. I don't have time. I've got the stopwatch that's really weighing down on my on my conscience right now. So I'll just get to the point of saying, what does that mean for a teacher? We consider ourselves teachers, and so for us, what that means is rewarding the effort, not so much the achievement of the goal in of itself. And to that end, there's a number of things that we will do to sort of incentivize students along the way, which we've historically found to be really effective. There's things like energy, you know, obviously there's a lot of gamification that we've thrown into the mix. So there's a lot of energy points, you know, badges. You can basically have very specific avatars that you can sort of build for yourself. And the more points you have, the cooler the avatars you can build, which to those of us old foggies out here may seem like really lame, but to those of you that really matter, the kids, my experience has been that's probably one of the best things that we could have done in terms of, you know, keeping you incentivized and keeping you moving forward. The second thing that we've done is we've tried to basically make sure that the platform is very personalized. The point being that the end goal doesn't change regardless of your abilities, your level of comfort with the subject area, your sort of just your the attraction that you have to the subject area. You know, that doesn't change. What does change is the pace at which you can get there. You know, and so I'll get asked very often by teachers about, I've got these slow children, what do you have to offer for them? And I say, nothing special. You know, essentially, all that it means is that some children will take 15 minutes to get to the end point, others will take 30 minutes, but that end point should never change. You know, that in of itself will never change, and that's something that we've done. The third thing that we've tried to do over here is basically make sure that the content itself is in a format that will actually really really incentivize you to pay attention. So as opposed to giving you like a dry, you know, compound interest problem, I'll give you a case in point. This is an actual problem on Khan Academy where the guy asks you that, I woke up this morning and I had 250 cockroaches in my house. Don't ask me how I counted them. They are growing at a rate of 30% every day. 3 days from now, how many cockroaches should I expect to have in my apartment? Again, you know, to those of us that are in the more mature category over here, you know, that may sound like flaky. You actually see one of these problems unfold in a classroom setting, you know, and kids run riot. There's problems that will basically deal with Bitcoin. There'll be problems that will deal with Game of Thrones, you know. There's a physics problem that says Jon Snow distributes heaters to all of his soldiers, you know, and then you've got to calculate the resistance, etc., etc. But you know, that is sort of one of the mechanisms that we've made sure is always available to keep them engaged.
And it does work. I saw an interaction amongst two kids. So one of them asked, you know, what are your points on Khan Academy? And he says, well, I got 2 lakh points. How many do you have? And he says, no, not many. And I asked him, why did you say not many? He says, because I want to tell him my points in the classroom, because I am at 4,50,000 points. But I want to see the look on his face when he gets to know that in the classroom. Right now, he's really happy with his points. So that motivation is certainly working. Sharad, my next question goes to you, actually. And there are tons of questions that I would want to ask you. But again, that stopwatch with the microseconds running is you know, weighing on my mind as well. So your organization has been empaneled to bring in Atal Tinkering Labs inside classrooms as well. And they're bringing finally tactile work happening and kids actually figuring out circuits and soldering irons, all the way to 3D printers and tons of other stuff. Two questions here. One, the educators who are now supposed to guide students on this, this wasn't part of our teacher training. Anil sir talked about B.Ed. colleges and some of them not even existing, but the ones that did exist, how to maneuver a tinkering lab was not a module. So what are you doing to help those teachers? And second, as kids start to do things on their own, are there ways for us to get them to collaborate with each other or to actually collaborate with students in other schools to further their learning experience?
Right. Thank you. First of all, thank you, and I'm very pleased to be in the panel, maybe the youngest one here. So on the first question, so to answer the first question, so whenever the new technologies or new programs come to the schools, usually the companies come up with the new programs from the techies perspective, not from the academic or curriculum oriented perspective. So what happens when the tinkering labs coming to the schools was very important, that how it aligns, how it integrates with the existing methodologies of that school. So we as a company have been into the STEM. Before Tinkering Lab, we have been doing the innovation labs. That was towards the curriculum-oriented science project-based learnings and demonstrative learning to visualize things in a real environment. Now the beauty, what comes with the Tinkering Lab, how it complements to us and to our schools, is that when this child has been learning something by seeing something practically happening, they come up with an idea. You can imagine how the Newton might have seen things happening, how a scientist sees things. That is how perfectly our students in our powered classrooms, they see it. Now the beauty, when the Tinkering Lab is there in the school, they can go into that laboratory, they can tweak around it, they can use that same 3D printer and soldering iron sheet to build things on their own. Now these are complementary things. Why the teachers in the current era, like science teacher, maths teachers, have been finding difficulty and might not be finding themselves very fit with the Tinkering Labs program was because they don't see the correlation. But the correlation comes if a biology teacher is teaching a concept of heart, how she can tell them or she can demonstrate different things when using the 3D printer of you creating a 3D heart of their own. So that is, the mathematics teachers can solve a lot of probability problems by creating a probability games through developing equipments in that 3D printing, in that particular Tinkering Labs. So that combination is really important, and how the kids will get excited, then comes the methodology part. That is on the, say, if you use the design thinking, that this is not typical, you learn the basics, then you go advanced, then you learn the, actually in the end, by the 11th or 12th grade, you're creating a product. That is now, it should not happen. It happens reverse side. You show them, this is the product you need to create. Can you create it? They get excited. I am so young, can I create this thing? So they then start thinking that what all things I need to learn to build that particular thing. That is how it progresses. Then they start small things and build things. And there are tools available through which at a very young age, you can create a machines which is having, you can create a vehicle with a suspension system or various machines without even any of the coding. That is design tinkering or mechanical tinkering. So kids get excited. On the last part, on the peer learning part, so we have a collaboration with the tinkeringlabs.com, which is where they started tinkering in United States 10 years ago, from where the program came into India. So we have already been doing it very basic level, let's say on the, you can say, let's say on the WhatsApp groups. So they organize competitions and these challenge approaches. They just give a challenge that this machine, can you create this challenge? Can you create this machine? The kids across the schools get that excited. They use the tools available in the Tinkering Labs. And then can chat on the WhatsApp groups. Let's make a team between this school and that school and create a product. And the, we have been doing this. One of our school in Shimla competed and went among the first three finalists, who was like, one school was from Spain and one was from US. So that is how they partner, they collaborate, share ideas. And the challenge approach is something very unique which enables Tinkering Labs and excites them. And those who are really tech-savvy students are like very fortunate to have this in the schools.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that very concise but very to-the-point answer. Collaboration is certainly going to improve the learning atmosphere for everybody around. Bhanu, I want to go to you, and I want you to get your advisory hat on. We've got different stakeholders in the room, from students, teachers, school heads, school management. And Podar, is Raghav here in the room still? Okay. So when Raghav was speaking, Raghav had spoken about AR, VR, MR, and some other R combinations. And we're experiencing them happening in our schools across the world. While our assessment system is still expecting us to give a mark to a child which gets them admission to university. So my question to you is, how do we actually make this learning relevant to the system? And again, is there a tip that you can offer to the teachers to weave it into the curriculum?
So I think when we look at, I'll answer this in a lens of future classroom scope, right? So the future classroom, obviously the classrooms do exist for the learner. I wouldn't even use the word student, I would use the word learner. And then the entire experience or entire strategy about getting it right is to worry about the learner's experience. What is the experience we are creating for the learner who's sitting in the classroom, whether it is a classroom or a whatever room that is, right? Now, if you approach the whole thing from that particular perspective and that particular lens, then what needs to really happen is to figure out among the various tools which are available in the market, in my school, even in the school, there are a lot of tools which some teachers use, some teachers don't use, and all of that stuff. So then there is this work which the teacher needs to go through as to how do I mix these things together, right? And when we talk about mixing these things together, one of the skill gap which we have is that we as a nation haven't been teaching our teachers how to think about technopedagogy. So there's a pedagogy which is normal pedagogy, the non without any tech intervention. But the moment you bring tech and tools into the play, the way the pedagogic construct changes, we haven't yet started working enough on equipping our teachers to look at, okay, these are the six tools I have. This is what I need to teach. This is my learning outcome. Firstly, how do I choose which tool to use? And how do I embed that into this? So the whole process is basically called technopedagogy. We see some schools actually pioneering and trying to get to it, but as an ecosystem, we have not yet started that journey. And we see this journey happening in some of the European schools, and some of the schools in Singapore are starting to do this. But this is imperative. Even if the schools do not move, what will happen is the learner will demand out of the school for this to happen, because what we are seeing in the progressive households is that the learning environment in the home is sometimes far more congenial than what is happening in the classroom. So you see very smart kids who are engaged outside the classroom in many different ways. The moment they come into the classroom, they become troublemakers to the teacher. In fact, it happens like that because the teacher is unable to engage the intellect or the enthusiasm or the energy that child has, right? So all of this is about, you know, figuring out the technopedagogy and the teacher really thinking about the experience I'm creating for my learner. So if the lens changes like that, then I think the future can really happen. Because if we really look at the last 20 years, the reality is that 90% of our classrooms haven't changed, right? Now, what gives us the belief that in the next 10 years or 20 years, change will happen? Change will only happen when the school leaders and the teachers are really bothered about the experiences they created for the learners. And once that anchor shifts, everything else will automatically start falling in place, because the teachers are pretty creative, right? I think sometimes the structure comes in the way of the teachers for innovating.
I agree with especially the last comment. The structure comes in the way. It reminds me of something I'd read a long while back. Often schools don't train their teachers for their fear. What will happen if I train and this person leaves?
What will happen if a bad teacher stays back?
That's exactly what I was going to say. But they don't look at it from the point of view of what will happen if this teacher who's not getting trained actually stays. So there has to be some Lego block training that has to come in to prepare us. I want to go to the youngest panelist on the stage. First question is a simple question. How does it feel?
It feels amazing sitting, you know, among such great people.
I'm very sure that you would have many, many more opportunities like this in your life.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to.
So my question to you is, we talked about Lego blocking. And Kathleen, in her presentation, if you were attentive, was talking about how classrooms are actually starting to shift. She was talking about new spaces, etc. If you could change one thing about the classroom that you are in right now, what would that one thing be?
So basically, I would make education all fun. Like, most of the children
You can only change one thing, right? Because if you have to change everything, then you have to be secretary education. And even secretary education, secretary education also finds it very difficult to change everything. So change one thing. change one thing.
So that one thing would be to make everything, like, everything practical. Everything we study, more than theoretical, it has to be practical. Because when we do it, we memorize it more than when we read it. So that's the one thing which I would like to change. I personally feel I remember things which I have done practically rather than, you know, just sitting and reading, more than ratta marna.
Lovely. Thank you very much for that answer. Can we hear it for her? Hi. Do you want to present this opportunity to a couple more people in the audience?
Sure.
So would you join your group back? And
so
we'll vacate the chair for I am this time. Thank you very much for coming. You can leave the mic here as well. This time I'm hoping somebody much younger is going to come and join us. Okay, there's one person. Are you going to the toilet or you come here? You come here? Come on in, then run up to the stage. What's your name?
My name is Aditya. I'm from Inventure.
Lovely. Take a seat. So now these people have been giving a lot of answers, right? And we ask you a lot of questions in school and then expect you to give all the answers. I give you a free run. You can ask us any question on anything that is wrong with the way we teach you. Ask a question that, you know, you think is a relevant question to you.
So personally, I don't want to criticize any of you or anything.
Yeah.
But I'm asking this question to Mr. Vipul. So from the Khan Academy, how do you make things more practical, as she said, to your students? How do they feel the connection between you and the teacher? Because the teacher is more of an online person, right? Will they feel that emotional and connection to the student?
That's a great question. And quite honestly, I mean, thank you to the young lady who just talked about the fact that we need to make things more practical. I think you basically touched upon the same thing about saying, you know, don't give me a question along, if I bought 100 watermelons, because who buys 100 watermelons, seriously? You know, so, you know, that actually is one of sort of the founding tenets of Khan Academy in terms of how they go about designing content, designing videos. Two things that they look at. One is the practicality and usefulness. Second is ability to grab attention, because we think both of those are essentially, you know, I wouldn't call it a crisis because that would be an overstatement, but really important things to basically do when you are creating content for the age group that you guys are in. So that's something that every content creator at Khan Academy goes through literally 3 to 6 months of training before they can actually start to publish content that you will actually see. You know, so whether it's videos, whether it's problems, whether it's notes that they're writing, all of the above will only start appearing when those elements start to really manifest themselves in that content. So that's one thing. The second thing is that I think you basically talked about how do we sort of maintain that going forward. So now I've got to the point where I've started to create good content. As a content creator, how do I make sure that stays that way? Quite honestly, one thing that we do is that some of the people that we will hire are just by nature among the most creative people you're ever likely to meet. You know, so it's not a fluke that the kind of problems you will have will involve, like, you know, imagine you're in the water and you're being chased by a shark, you know, and I'm not sure what the rest of the problem is, but that guy's got my attention right there. So, you know, those kind of problems are things that basically are the product of very fertile creative minds, which are the kind of people that we go looking for. In fact, finding a job as a content creator at Khan Academy is probably one of the hardest jobs you could ever look for anywhere. The last time we hired, I think they had like, I think some 400 odd finalists, out of which they picked 2 people, you know, and so it's not, it's that's the reason that it's as hard as it is to come aboard and create content here. So I hope we do a better job though, you know.
Thank you. Vipul, I want Bhanu to add to this. Because while your intervention is online intervention, and you're not physically present in the school, but Bhanu's work involves in actually making theory into practical work. Do you want to add to that answer? And do you want to repeat your question once again?
Okay, so one thing I would add to a physical classroom is to connect more with things that they like. Yeah. For example, somebody's really good in sports, but they know nothing about math. They can learn about where to shoot. For example, you can learn about the hypotenuse angle and things like that. Or somebody's good at sewing or something. You can connect that to the subjects, which will help them to understand the concept yeah. better.
So is Tinkering Lab actually trying to make that connect?
Yes.
Yeah. So I would say the Tinkering Lab is more about co-curricular higher-end technology. But what we are doing in Innovation Lab is something like we have a 10-minute activity also just before lunch. So we have a simple activity. I'll just call everyone to attract that matchstick to a magnet. Because matchstick doesn't have a, I think, it's not look like a metal. But can we attract a matchstick to a magnet? This is a simple thing where you, when you are taught a chemical reaction, chemical changes in a matters, particles, how do you react when you are listening the term chemical changes? And how do you react when you are seeking a term like attract a magnet to a matchstick? So these are the two relations where a person who might not be interested in chemistry can get interested. So in Innovation Lab, we have developed 90 products which are like which are working tools which you can demonstrate during the classrooms. So while I was seeing his question, something we also use sometimes to train, to educate or share the knowledge to the teachers, we also create videos. But we encourage that in the classrooms, the teachers use the real tool and demonstrate live. So we see a great proposition that kids have a lot of technology access at their homes, and they have tablets and they have internet. So they can utilize, they can use the best of the content, and content like Khan Academy has been really helpful when the parents might not provide sufficient time. But when they are actually coming to the school, so the purpose of being the school, purpose of being a teacher, is always there. So we are trying to supplement and complement what is there to increase that engagement within the classrooms. So that kind of the tools are something we have created. So multiple, all science from grade 6 to 10th can be made more fun and interesting by these kind of tools.
Right. Thank you very much for the answer, Bhanu. So does it look like there is work in progress?
Yes.
Yeah, there is work in progress. We are trying to change to becoming slightly more practical. Thank you very much for showing the courage to come up on the stage. And again, sorry? Yeah, that's a good idea, but that's not what I want to promote. So yeah, thank you very much for showing courage and coming. And can from the audience, can we hear it once again for our young learner? Right, thank you. I've got 2 minutes and 40 seconds left, but I want to bring on stage one more portion of stakeholders that often go, you're already coming. This time I was trying to get your teacher on board, but come on. How are you? How are you?
I'm fine.
Do you want to introduce yourself to the group?
Yeah, I'm Amay Acharya, great and student from NPSI myself. Proud to be here, proud to meet all of you.
I was really hoping I'd be able to call his teacher, but you know, he showed us the way. Okay, young man. I give you a choice. Do you want to answer a question or do you want to ask a question?
Could I do something between both of them?
Sure, go ahead. Okay. Surprise me.
Yeah. So I've been doing some amount of reading, and according to my research, what you're all targeting is to improve the educational levels in most of the students. But students, especially in India, are all teenagers. And according to 7 most effective habits of teenagers, written by Sean Covey, he says that most of these teenagers are driven by paradigms. Now, these paradigms include maybe rivalry with competitors, which right now I have a lot, and most of them do. But what he says is, all of these are actually in the end going to make you crumble. It's going to make you crack. But we need to start shifting our paradigms to something much more effective, something inwards. Just like Mrs. Nagli said and Mr. Poda said, we should not label them. We need to bring about a paradigm such as honesty, hard work in them, which is actually going to inspire them to do more. So that means they have to search inwards, get a paradigm, and then move forward. So my question is, what would you do to bring this about in all of them?
I think, Bhanu, do you want to attempt this?
I think the question actually says a lot about who the future learner is. So if we cannot create experiences for him, right? So the challenge we have as educators or people who are in the space is immense. So thank you for the question. So I'll answer your question with an example of what we do, yes. Right? Is that okay? So I'm on the board of Worldreader, and it's an organization which works about promotion of reading and in the classrooms and households, right? One of the things we are primarily in India, we are working with grades nursery 1 and 2, and then we'll slowly go up, hopefully. What we are doing there with the teachers is basically trying to encourage the teachers to use storytelling techniques to create learning outcomes. Okay. And we have done an activity of mapping a variety of publisher stories with the curriculum framework. And when the teacher starts using the story in the classroom, at some point in time, the teacher is trained to pause the story and allow the children to take different characters in the story and then allow them to build the story. Yes. Right? The publisher and the author would have written the story to go in one way, but the teacher starts narrating halfway, stops, and allows the children to become those characters and finish the story. And at the end, the teacher compares the ending which the classroom has created and the publisher's, the author's thing. And that is where there's a conversation of, why did you make the character do this? Why didn't you make the character do that? Why was your character fighting with that character?
Yeah.
Right? So there are all these things which can be very beautifully brought out by using collaborative story techniques in classrooms. And we are intentionally starting to do that more in the primary grades, because if stories are used very powerfully in primary grades, the interest in trying to understand stories will be sparked. The moment that is sparked, the child will start figuring out that the only way for me to immerse into stories is to start reading. And even those people who otherwise normally struggle to start reading will actually convert their struggle into an interest to start reading. And once that happens till grade 3 or 4, if the child starts already reading, then the child can come to Khan Academy, he can go to Tinkering Labs, he can go wherever beyond his classroom and learn, right? So that's the way we are trying to address this, yeah.
Thank you very much for that. I think very apt answer there. Our time has run out, as much as I'm loving doing this. Because you see, I had already told my panelists what questions I was going to ask. But 10 minutes before the session started, we changed the format. So now none of us knew what questions were going to come to us. So
isn't that precisely what Unconference is?
Exactly. That's what it is. So for the three, let's hear it first for the three young people who came and rattled us and made some of us very uncomfortable with the questions, because we know that what you're asking for is exactly what we need to be doing. And trust us, we are attempting. I would end this with a personal story, an anecdote. It'll take a minute. So when my daughter was born, my nephew, who was then 2.5 years old, who was the only child at home, was told, little baby is coming. Little baby will get you a gift. So there was this tricycle he'd been wanting. So we'd wrapped it up, kept it at home, that he has something to look forward to when the little baby arrives, and now he has to share attention with another child. So the baby was born, this child goes to the hospital and looks at the little baby, 2.5 years old, he makes a few observations. His first observation was, little baby is very small. Okay, understandable. Little baby doesn't talk. Okay, no, little baby doesn't talk, he's only a day old. If little baby doesn't talk, how will little baby buy a gift? If he doesn't talk, how will he buy a gift? You've been telling me all this while he's coming, he's going to get me a gift. So all of us adults in the room are looking at each other, because we don't have an answer to this, we didn't think it through. And as he sees us looking at each other with no answers, He said, maybe online? While there is a teacher getting ready to enroll him in a nursery classroom next year and teach him letters of the alphabet. That's the curriculum that she's got for her. So the learner in our classroom is changing really fast. And as policymakers, as promoters, as leaders, educators, we need to understand this, that the learner has changed, the need has changed. We don't know what the future of classroom learning will look like, but we are curious about it. I want to thank my panelists to come and to face the young learners along with me today, and to Priyadeep to actually having young learners in the conference. Let's retain this format. And to people who did not go to sleep during this panel, thank you very much. Have a good day.